These are this afternoon's top stories. New policies to be implemented in the agriculture sector in 2016. No violation of citizen rights in Guyana's terrorism bill. And millions in dangers from threat of Mississippi River flooding. Good afternoon and welcome to the ZIZ Midday Newscast. Today is Wednesday, 30th December 2015. I am J.D. Keynes. We begin with news on the local scene. The agriculture sector can expect major changes in 2016. While speaking during a recent radio interview, Prime Minister Dr. the Honorable Timothy Harris said in the new year, new policies will be implemented to enhance the agriculture sector.
One worrying factor is that agriculture continues to be rain-fed. No rain, urine drought, very little production. We want to change that, and the only way to change that, or the viable way to change that, is to invest more in science and the application of technology. And we are going to want to do more of these things and develop more resilient agricultural policies.
Prime Minister Harris also announced incentives for farmers with the introduction of the new policies.
We are going to bring some relief to the farmers, and I could mention that. Especially on animal food, we are going to, farmers would enjoy a substantial reduction in the cost of animal food as a result of some policy initiatives that we would introduce, because we want agriculture to grow. Economy grows and agriculture falters. We are losing critical foreign exchange earning, which ought to be invested in those things which we can't produce. So we want to see more vitality from agriculture and also from local manufacturing.
Prime Minister Dr. the Honorable Timothy Harris. The Eastern Caribbean Central Bank, or ECCB, Monetary Council met on Monday, December 28th at the Ocean Terrace Inn in St. Kitts to deal with issues of governance related to the vacancy left by Sir K. Dwight Venner, who retired as the bank's governor in November of this year, after having served in that post for 26 years. The top two candidates for the post are Grenada's Timothy Antoine and St. Lucia's Dr. Hyginus Leon. Dr. Leon received his PhD from the University of Southampton and is a senior official at the International Monetary Fund, IMF, for close to 20 years. Timothy Antoine is an economist. He is presently the permanent secretary in the Ministry of Finance in Grenada. The special session was presided over by the chairman of the ECCB Monetary Council, the Honorable Victor Banks, who is also the chief minister of Anguilla. Other heads of government in attendance were St. Kitts and Nevis's Prime Minister, Dr. the Honorable Timothy Harris, Antigua and Barbuda's Prime Minister, the Honorable Gaston Brown, Prime Minister of Grenada, the Honorable Keith Mitchell, Premier of Montserrat, the Honorable Donaldson Romeo, the Prime Minister of St. Vincent and the Grenadines via teleconference, the Honorable Dr. Ralph Gonsalves, and Senator Miriam Blanchard of the Commonwealth of Dominica, who represented the Honorable Roosevelt Skerritt. St. Lucia abstained from the meeting. A search committee to find a new governor for the ECCB commenced its work on June 5th of this year. 18-year-old Neela Jones became the first representative of Nevis to capture the Hainsmith Caribbean Talented Teen title when she wowed the judges at the 36th edition of the pageant on Tuesday. Jones scored 723 points to secure the top spot, picking up the award for best theatrical appearance along the way. Following her coronation, she spoke with ZIZ News about the pageant.
I mean, although we have not been able to capture a crown, we did tonight, and I would just like to let everyone know we're small, but we tall and wide.
Jones said she remained confident and was most pleased with her performance in the theatrical appearance. She also spoke of the level of competition from the other contestants.
I believe that although they didn't capture the crown, they did an exceptional job. And by coming out here and representing their country, they did an exceptional job. And that in itself is a success.
Miss Dominica Lecretia Wallace placed first runner-up with 718 points, while Miss Grenada Aina Sanak amassed a total of 717.5 points and placed second runner-up. Miss Grenada also won the interview segment. The Best Evening Wear Award went to Miss United States Virgin Islands Akira Pickering Haynes, and Miss Anguilla Javoncia Proctor won the talent segment. Miss Jamaica Janelle Baldy won the Miss Photogenic Award. This year's pageant fielded 9 contestants, with other representatives coming from Barbados, St. Kitts, and St. Martin.
A lot of people think that fast bikes are cool, and the girls sure like the guys who ride them. But, like, so many things about life. the guard and be careful.
Having sex without a condom is like riding a bike without a helmet. It's just plain dumb. It's okay to have fun as long as you're smart about it. My name is Daniel the Lion Fortress, and I'm different, and I'm making a difference.
Live up. Love, protect, respect.
Regionally, Guyana's Legal Affairs Minister says there are no violation of citizens' rights in the terrorism bill. Here's more.
The misuse of provisions under the terrorism bill by the authority, extradition of persons stolen from Guyana, and stockpiling of mineral with radioactive materials in the mining sectors were among some of the concerns addressed at a public consultation organized by the Ministry of Legal Affairs on the Anti-Terrorism and Terrorist-Related Activities Bill of 2015. Attorney-at-law Glenn Hanneman questioned whether there was an attempt by the legislation to interfere in the working of the judiciary as it relates to extraditions.
My problem is that I feel that this section is unconstitutional in the sense that it is the legislature directing the judiciary to see an offense as political, but yet not directing them not to see it. And I'm worried about the taking away from our judiciary a lot of power.
I don't think the judiciary has a turn for this. The legislature can't take away nothing from the judiciary.
Well,
in the final analysis, when the judge has these three conflicting clauses or sections before it, the judge has to do the interpretation.
The Attorney General also addressed the issue of protests organized by citizens to voice their displeasure.
I'm concerned about government. By having the past government to charge those guys from Tenerife for trying to overthrow the government or something like that. Those, the ex-army captain. I remember it, and I'm sending a CEO as well against the government. How the government would use this bill to penalize opponents of the government.
And I would agree with the Honorable Attorney General. There's no way that people picketing and protesting, you know, under the Constitution, they have the right to do so. I don't see how that can ever come within the ambit of terrorism.
That's how it is, though.
The consultation was held at the Arthur Chung Conference Center on Monday and saw the participation of a number of groups including the private sector, Bankers Association and private citizens. The bill will be tabled in Parliament tomorrow. Reporting for Capital News, Ivor Wharton.
Some city businesses in St. Lucia say this Christmas was anything but merry for them. Don Nicholas reports.
One businessman reported an increase in sales this year as opposed to the last one. He attributes this success to good business decisions that the company made during the fiscal year.
Well, the thing is you learn from your experiences. You make different decisions. So we made different decisions this year, and according to those decisions, we were lucky, maybe we were lucky, and things improved, but slightly, a slight improvement over last year. It wasn't a drastic improvement, but whatever blessings we get, we're very thankful for them. So we count every blessing, and we're very positive. We have to stay positive about everything. No matter how bad things get, we have to try to stay positive.
But other businesses were not so fortunate. Most of them we spoke to painted a dismal picture, some of them not wanting to appear on camera. One businessman described the situation as terrible. Another said that it was no secret that the VAT had a negative impact on business.
Well, it's not no secret that the VAT has taken a toll on the island as a whole. And what you find is like less jobs. A lot of people unemployed. So a lot of people didn't have nothing coming in for the season, you know, so. You probably get a day work or two, and you could barely buy food or something else with that, you know.
The Prime Minister is predicting that 2016 will be a better year for the economy. A recent IMF report, according to him, had projected economic growth. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
Internationally, torrential downpours have swollen rivers in Illinois and Missouri, and mandatory evacuations are underway. In Missouri, flooding is blamed for at least 13 deaths, and flooding could affect more than 18 million people in states along the Mississippi River. Anna Werner reports.
The water has surrounded West Alton, Missouri, where residents were told Tuesday it's time to leave.
We emptied our basement out of anything important. We cleaned out the house of clothes.
As the Mississippi River threatened St. Louis County, it took teamwork to fill 20,000 sandbags. Officials pleaded for help and the community responded.
Just like the movie Field of Dreams, if you build it, they'll come.
The Army Corps of Engineers is monitoring 19 vulnerable levees on the rising Mississippi River and its tributaries. Missouri Governor Jay Nixon.
Water levels in some locations are predicted to exceed the historic crest during the Great Flood of 1993.
This was Hannibal, Missouri in July 1993 when the river crested 22 feet above flood stage. Nine states saw flooding, 50 people died. Nearly 150 major rivers and tributaries were affected. And the floodwaters caused a spectacle.
I drove in from Kansas last night just to come over here and look at this.
After flooding pushed untreated sewage from this plant into nearby rivers and streams, residents of High Ridge, Missouri fortified their treatment plant to keep the flood out of the drinking water supplied to thousands. In Union, Missouri, water crept up over porch steps as rescue boats skipped by. Cindy Nations claims her neighborhood isn't prone to flooding.
And they would not sell me flood insurance. So I've never been concerned about it.
Now, this is not the usual time of year for the Mississippi River to come over its banks, and it's been more than 20 years since this kind of event has happened in the area, but all of that December rainfall is all winding up down here.
In more international news, Ethan Couch, the fugitive Texas teen known for his so-called affluence and defense, is expected to return to the U.S. from Mexico on Wednesday. Couch and his mother were arrested on Monday night at Puerto Vallarta apartment complex after being on the run for about 3 weeks. Here's that story.
Tarrant County officials say Ethan Couch had a going-away party of sorts shortly before fleeing town with his mother, Tanya. During the nearly three-week chase, federal and state investigators followed dozens of sightings, some of which were false, and a tip that the mother and son had driven this pickup truck to the Mexican border.
Christmas Eve is about the time that I think that the really kind of concrete information came in. The problem with it was, as you can imagine, Puerto Vallarta at Christmas time, tremendous amount of tourists.
Their search eventually led Mexican authorities helping with the investigation to this Puerto Vallarta apartment complex. According to reports, Couch and his mother moved here after first staying at a resort. A picture taken shortly after Couch's arrest reveals that he had dyed his blonde hair black. In a statement on Tuesday, Couch's attorneys said, "We have not had the opportunity to speak with our client." Couch disappeared earlier this month, shortly after this video was posted to Twitter. It appears to show him at a party with drinking, possibly violating his 10-year probation. In 2013, when Couch was 16, he killed four people and paralyzed another in a drunk driving crash. During the trial, his defense argued that he suffered from affluenza, a controversial condition of his privileged, wealthy upbringing that failed to teach him responsibility. Todd Clement is an attorney representing the victims' families.
There's no question that Ethan Couch was raised in a way where he was taught to avoid responsibility, that he was taught that the rules don't apply to him and his family. I think now that we're seeing that indeed they do apply.
Couch will likely be placed in a juvenile detention facility until he turns 19 in April. In January, there's a hearing set to move his case over into adult court. As for Tanya Couch, she faces a third-degree felony charge for helping him escape, and that carries a sentence of up to 10 years in prison.
And now taking a look at the weather. Temperatures today will peak at 75 degrees Fahrenheit with a moderate breeze blowing from the northeast at 13 miles per hour. Today will be partly sunny with brief passing showers. Tonight, skies will also be partly cloudy with brief passing showers. Seas are rough with waves of up to 8 feet. Warnings remain in effect for mariners and sea bathers. Sunset for today will be at 5:47 and sunrise for tomorrow will be at 6:40. AM. And that brings us to the end of ZIZ's Midday Newscast. Join us this evening for these stories and more in detail. I have been your presenter, JD Keynes. Have a great afternoon.